The desert of Utah's Dixie was frontier unlike any other the men of the many generations of Westover frontiersmen had ever had to face. It lacked the timber and seasonality of the fields in Connecticut and Massachusetts. It lacked the humidity and moisture of eastern Canada. It lacked the fertility of the Ohio Valley. Of Utah's Dixie, it was said, it was never much of a country in which to make money, but it was a fine country in which to make men. Edwin Westover came into the world in 1824. His parents were young, quite poor, and were looking to find a place where the family could permanently settle in Ohio. His father, Alexander, was 26 years old. His mother, Electa, was only 22. The first 10 years of Edwin's life would be among the most stable of his 54 years on Earth. Even though his parents are on record for moving 3 times during those years, the hope of the family was secured with the acquisition of the family homestead in a small town named Rush, near Goshen, Ohio. The family grew as another brother, Albert, was born and then died. And then came along 2 brothers, Charles and Oscar. But when his father, Alexander, died in 1834, the test began of constant challenge, change in faith that would shape the character of Edwin Westover. Where would it take him, and how would he respond? His first test came in a separation from his mother at the age of 10. Unable to support her family, Electa had no choice but to farm her children out to other people. For the next decade, Edwin more or less worked as a hired hand in the home of neighbors and friends who could help feed and clothe him. For Edwin, it placed a desire in his heart to have family once again and to find a way where he could again see his mother happy. At the age of 19, he married a local beauty by the name of Sarah Darrow. A little more than a year later, young Edwin and Sarah became parents. But within months, tragedy struck. Young Sarah died, leaving 20-year-old Edwin a widower. He had nowhere to turn but his mother, who understood all too well the circumstances he was facing as a single parent. The common ground they shared galvanized their relationship. As Electa found faith in the lessons from young Mormon missionaries that same summer, Edwin too found hope in their message of eternal families. Both were baptized. Edwin and Electa grew in their faith as they rallied to raise Edwin Jr. together. Within a couple of years, he met the young Sarah Jane Burwell, and though only 15 years old, took her to wife in the winter of 1848. Sarah's parents were also recent converts to the LDS Church. As the call for Zion to gather in the West built up steam, the Westover clan joined with other local converts to join the migration. Thanks to the sale of property that young Sarah Jane had inherited, Edwin was able to outfit the group for travel, and they joined the massive body of saints in Brigham Young's wagon train of 1848. Edwin's little brother Charles, as a single man, was employed by Rastus Snow as a teamster driving one of his families in an ox-drawn wagon west. This close relationship with the future apostle would play an integral part in the history of the family in Utah, and for the next 3 decades, the Westovers and Elder Snow would remain closely associated. With nearly 3,000 other pioneers, the Westovers spent that entire summer making their way to Salt Lake City. Survival was the watchword that first winter in Utah. The Westovers took up residence in the old fort, a central place of refuge, packed with families, crammed into small spaces for that winter of 1848. As church authorities worked to organize the settlers, they divided Salt Lake City into 19 wards, giving each family 2 large lots. The first a site near the city center of a little more than an acre in size. The second was a 10-acre plot for farming further away from the city. The Westovers were assigned to the 9th ward, and a lot located near 5th East and 4th South, in present-day Salt Lake City. Here they would build, dig, plant, and worship for the next 7 years. Both Edwin and Charles were employed in hauling timber from the canyons, erecting homes and buildings on family lots, and tilling the earth for desperately needed food. It was a frugal and bare existence. Charles records in his history that he arrived in Salt Lake on the 20th of September, 1848, only clothes he wore as possessions. He didn't even have a blanket or money to buy food, even if food were available to buy. Brigham Young admonished the saints to provide for themselves by growing their own food, making their own clothes, educating their own children, and relying on prayer and hard work to make the desert blossom as a rose. This would be their way for at least the next 30 years in Zion. Aside from what farm implements they could bring with them, the Westover family really had little to start their life with in Zion. It would take years to accomplish a sense of prosperity, and life in this new wilderness would teach them how quickly they could lose it all. These Salt Lake City years were a building time for the Westover family. Not only would their industry need to grow, but so too would the family have to expand in order to survive. Edwin and Sarah welcomed four children during their first years in the Valley, and Charles would become one of the first in the Valley to get married in Utah, selecting Eliza Haven as his bride. Both Edwin and Charles were intimately involved in church affairs. Both attended the School of the Prophets and answered the call when men were needed for special projects. During the Utah War and the march of Johnston's army on Salt Lake City, Edwin was assigned to the company of Lot Smith of the Mormon Raiders, who were assigned to harass the army as it made its way to Utah and down Echo Canyon. They would burn the prairie to deny feed for the army livestock, steal horses and cattle, and destroy supply lines and forts that supported the army on their way. Charles, too, would spend time away from the family to help with church efforts. His was a fight of a different kind. Brigham Young's attitude about the Indians was that he would rather feed them than fight them, but the many mixed tribes of natives living in Utah Territory seemed to take varied approaches in dealing with the Saints. Charles was called and served as an Indian fighter, as a private in the Navajo Legion, who frequently had to fend off Indian raids and attacks on Mormon settlements. Edwin and Charles were both raised as youth to work on farms, and this is where they dedicated their time as their fortunes improved, developing neighboring farm properties located in Cottonwood, near the Fort Union area of present-day Murray, Utah. Pioneer life was difficult, and early church membership required sacrifice. During the years of 1856 and 1857, the Saints in Utah were called to repentance during a period known as the Mormon Reformation. Many, including Electa, were rebaptized in the faith. Men were known to be called on missions from the pulpit on Sundays, and entire families were frequently reassigned to help settle new towns in the territory. These life-changing scenarios were common for nearly all families professing to be Latter-day Saints and disciples of Jesus Christ. In 1857, life changed dramatically for both Edwin and Charles, as both were called to take on plural wives, a principle less understood today than it was even then. But they were called to do it, and being faithful, they and their wives answered the call. Edwin married an 18-year-old recent immigrant named Ann Finley, who had made the handcart trek to Zion in 1856 with her parents. Charles married Mary Shumway, a good friend to his wife Eliza, who was 21 years of age. Towards the end of the 1850s, Edwin and his brother were separated for a brief period. Charles was called to work the cotton mission in southern Utah, an area that was under the direction of Erastus Snow. Edwin and family moved to where his Aunt Hannah, Electa's sister, lived in Grantsville, where Edwin farmed for a few years, until he too was called to take his families to work in the colonization efforts of southern Utah. Edwin was called as a missionary serving in the 8th Corps of the 70, and lived for a time in St. George, where he would lend his services in working on the temple there. He moved frequently due to his assignments, especially those first few years in Utah's Dixie. In 1865, Edwin and his families moved to the tiny settlement of Hebron, and it was there that Edwin suffered some of the most challenging days of his life. Hebron was close to nowhere and located at a fairly high elevation. The little town was subject to tough winter weather. Its isolated location and lack of availability for goods and services made sustaining two growing families a monumental challenge not only for Edwin, but for all settlers in Hebron. Not all who were called to Dixie survived the experience. While some died in their efforts to build industries and towns, others abandoned the effort as too difficult. Edwin and Charles both have a difficult history in southern Utah as they fought to survive and had to start over again and again. In Hebron, Edwin tended to his sheep and to the herds of the church. His responsibilities were large. He took into his home a stranger by the name of Thomas Fuller, an Australian convert and a single man who was about 50 years of age. On a cold and snowy February night, Fuller went to check on the livestock and never came back. They later found him face down in a field about a quarter mile from the Westover home. When he was found, Fuller's condition immediately shocked those who were charged with preparing his body for burial. His clothes were filthy and thin, and they were shocked to see he was covered with lice from head to toe. After he was buried, Edwin was called before a church court investigating the circumstances behind Fuller's death. He was put on the defensive about everything, from how much the family he was supporting required, to the share of work he did in support of the settlement. The question wasn't that Edwin was responsible for the man's death, but rather for his overall condition, a fact that Edwin disputed strongly. Edwin explained that Fuller was dismissed from a previous job because he had lice. He explained that no one else would take him in, and if Edwin had provided him with new clothes, he would have had no clothes himself to wear. Bishop Zaropulsifer took the line of questioning to spiritual matters and asked Edwin if he had been attending to his prayers. Edwin admitted he had neglected it for some time. That was reason enough for Pulsifer to chastise Edwin, telling him he had, quote, not done his duty as an elder in Israel, unquote. For his neglect, Edwin was charged with rebaptism and had to make a full confession to the body of saints in Hebron. Edwin humbled himself and made the confession, but appealed the decision of rebaptism to the presiding authority in southern Utah, Erastus Snow. The record does not show any more mention of the event, and Edwin was never rebaptized. He remained in Hebron for a couple of more years, but took a hard stance against Pulsifer, refusing to move with settlers when the direction came to gather Hebron citizens in closely aligned houses for protection against the Indians. Within a short period of time, Edwin moved his families to Hamblin, another struggling outpost supporting the Cotton Mission and efforts in St. George. Here he would live for several years, serving as postmaster for the community. But living conditions here were equally harsh and challenging. In the winter of 1869, a letter arrived with bad news from Anne's family in northern Utah. Her brother William Jr. had died unexpectedly in Mendon, Utah, leaving a widow with several small children. A family council was held and the decision was made for Anne, who was pregnant with her fifth child, to go with her children to Mendon to help William's widow and her aging parents. Edwin continued to serve where he was called and he grew in responsibility. A family story has survived through the years that speaks of Edwin's spiritual side. Edwin was traveling with his family and had a problem crossing the swollen waters of a river near St. George. They camped along the river for several days as they worked to figure a way across, but with food running out and the need to cross overgrowing every minute, the family knelt in prayer to seek guidance in finding their way out of the situation. Edwin prayed specifically for help, and shortly after rising from his knees while in prayer, they spotted some Indians who had come up to the river. Though Indians were feared and most took great precautions to avoid contact with them, Edwin felt impressed to communicate their needs to them. Using hand gestures and broken language, Edwin was able to get the point across that they needed the local ferryman to come to their aid. The Indians were able to find help locally, and the needed assistance soon arrived. With his family spread between northern and southern Utah, the importance of gospel promises became more dear to Edwin. As the completion of the St. George Temple neared, he was able to prepare family names, and with his mother and his brother and their wives, went to the temple to renew covenants and do the work for the family members departed. He was set apart in 1877 to serve yet another mission, this time in Arizona. Just as Edwin and family were in transit to Arizona, he came down with typhoid fever, and after a brief period of time, died of the illness in Johnson, a small settlement east of Kanab. He was 54 years old. Charles would outlive him by another 40 years, becoming one of the last surviving members of the Pioneer Trek of 1848. By that time, the combined family efforts of Edwin and Charles Westover had taken serious hold in the West, with the family firmly established in Arizona, southern Utah, central Utah, and northern Utah, and even up into Idaho. Within this one generation, a stronger foothold for the future was established, a foundation that would lead to a rising generation of family members who would become college-educated and proficient in a variety of careers. They became builders and school teachers, doctors and mechanics, farmers and soldiers. All manner of talent was brought to bear in the generations of the Westover families of the 20th century in the West. Once again, the foundation of it all was rooted in faith and in the belief that the family, the Westover family, is eternal. Please join us at westoverfamilyhistory.org as we tell the stories of each generation of the Westover family.